Hello, good morning. Thank you for having me here. Well, today I'm mainly talking about, well, as you know, cultural diplomacy itself began to receive more attention in the last maybe 2-3 decades, you know, globally. So in Panama, it was no exception, and we actually have a very recent developing history with cultural diplomacy in our country. And very shortly, I'll explain how recent, actually. But first, I would like to explain just exactly what we are trying to promote in terms of cultural diplomacy. What is Panamanian culture? Panamanian culture is a mix of the indigenous culture, the indigenous tribes and their cultures, which, I mean, well, back in the times of the Spanish conquest, it was maybe around 60 in the region. Now it's around 7, which is still a lot for a small country as ours. And they are still very, very individual cultures on its own. And they are heavily protected by the government as well and promoted as part of Panamanian culture as a whole. The other part of Panamanian culture is the Spanish influence, the Spanish and Latino, because as well, we have a lot of Italian immigrants who came to Panama and settled there. And we have a lot of cultural ties with what maybe Spain and Italy. So a lot of our typical, our traditional dresses and paintings and that sort of thing is influenced especially by Spain. So these are, it's a particular mix. I mean, it's different from the rest of the region. It's similar, but it's still very unique in a way. And it's not perhaps as well known as others. And that's part of what the government has been trying to change in the last couple of years. Now, when I went back, going back to the recent development of cultural diplomacy in Panama, while there has always been a cultural institute in Panama dedicated to promoting culture both within this, within our country and abroad, it hasn't, until before April 2014, this year, it hadn't actually joined into a proper promotion plan with our Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So that is how recent it is. We actually created the Cultural Diplomacy Department at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in April this year. And so it, before that, it used to be very dependent on certain cooperation agreements and commitments with other countries which were with whom we already had strong ties, both commercial and cultural. A lot of Latin American countries, United States, and certain European countries that with whom we already shared culture, like Spain, and certain commercial ties like Netherlands or Germany. So going to the Department of Cultural Diplomacy that was created this year, and I basically, they have designed a promotion plan in together with our Institute of our National Institute of Culture, in order to properly support our artists, our endeavors abroad. Now, I have worked at our embassy here for almost 5 years. So I was dealing with arranging cultural events or Panamanian participation in cultural events here in London before the implementation of this department. So it usually came to the embassy to, you know, made the reach out to our National Institute of Culture and the institutes here in UK and then other ministries or departments in our government in order to bring about, you know, just one event depending on what it was. So it took a while, it has taken a while since we have achieved political and economical stability for cultural diplomacy to give, to be given the importance that it has held for a very long time, and perhaps it wasn't as appreciated before. It always came as maybe as I would like. I wish I had a better word right now. As a side dish to commercial agreements or to the commercial promotion of Panama, it used to come first, commerce, and then culture. So, by creating this department, they are trying to to balance it out. Now we're doing very well in the commercial side, and you know, we would like to answer those questions. You know, what is Panama? What is, you know, what do they eat? What do they dress? What do they celebrate? You know, it, all these questions, because it's interesting. I mean, a lot of people wouldn't know it unless they've actually been there. And so that's also, that's another a strategy that has been coming, growing with time as well. You know, it's on a par with tourism, but just the promotion of Panamanian culture as well, just for it to be more widely acknowledged. So some, for instance, I would like to mention just a couple of the subjects that have been the focus of recent years and that led to the creation of this department. For instance, in film, Panama is currently, as starting from last year actually, we've started hosting a Central America Film Festival. Now, this is you know, very new for the region, and to actually do something together in terms of culture, not just politics and commerce, it's a big achievement, and this department has given it the importance it has by working with our Ministry of Commerce in order to bring about this festival and also to promote Panamanian filmmakers, which so far have few, but are increasing in order to give them you know, more opportunities. For instance, this year we actually gave our first nomination for a film documentary called Invasion. It's the first film to be submitted for nomination for an Academy Award for foreign films in the United States. So this, it doesn't seem as much compared to other countries, but for Panama it is a big step, and especially having the support of the government. Also in terms of the jazz festival, which we also have every year, and it's rather big also with some big jazz stars from Panama, such as, I don't know if anyone of you know, Danilo Perez, perhaps. So it's with his help as well, because he's also well known abroad, and we're trying to promote that aspect as well, musics, the typical dance, our typical dance with La Pollera, which is our traditional dress. I'm sorry we don't have, I didn't bring the PowerPoint. I don't know if any of you have seen our dress. Now I'm taking just a minute to show you, just because it's website. We have, well, there's the visitpanama.com. You can see a lot of information there. Oh, sorry. Oh, no. No, I'll just show a picture here, actually, if that's okay. Just a brief. I don't actually have the. Well, this is from one of our indigenous tribes in Panama. That's the Chocoe, actually. That's in the Darien part of Panama. And our dress, this is part of our dress. I'm sorry, I don't have the actual. This is a part of our dress. It's actually quite spectacular. And I'm not saying it because it's from my country, but it is a rather spectacular view as well. And the dance as well is very intricate and different from actually even from the region. So we are, the government has taken upon itself to promote it more, not just as something you do for investors after a long conference. It's worth to make it sure that it's worth noticing on its own as well. Sorry, I'm just checking as well what's it we're doing here. Yes, well, in Panama itself, where we have for now, it's been longer in Panama, which is exchanging, doing more forums for cultural exchange in Panama as well. In terms of fairs, festivals, where all the embassies based in Panama participate, and there are, you know, the dances and the food and the crafts, and so Panama as a center, it's because being a transit point as well, it's just it's very easy for there to be it's a great platform for a cultural diplomacy. So we have taken advantage of that for quite a while now. And what has changed now is that we are taking it to the other level of bringing it here, bringing it to United States, to South America, to Asia. You know, we are expanding this because we are generally perhaps quite accustomed to, because we can have a lot of influx of immigrants and travelers. We are perhaps used to being the platform for it in Panama, in the country, in our country, and now we're looking to bring it abroad. So, yes, I guess that's the main point of my speech, just basically how Panama has taken in this very relatively recent development in cultural diplomacy, and taken it seriously and planning to do even much more in this department. In this year and the years to come. I don't know if I think that should be it around it, if that's right.
Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you very much, Ms. Montenegro. We'd be happy also to take questions or comments for the culture attaché from the Embassy of Panama. Okay, please.
Morning. Thank you very much for your speech. You spoke about the migrants contribute to the building of culture of Panama, if I understand well, and in particular Spanish and Italians. Could you more specifically indicate what kind of elements we from Italy brought to the building of culture in Panama? Thank you very much.
Yeah, of course. Actually, well, one of the most obvious is perhaps the traditional dress, la pollera, which is actually based in a specific dress from a region in Spain. I believe it was Valencia. I'm not 100% sure the region in Spain, but it's based on that. And when brought in Panama, it just evolved into what is now la pollera. And it also applies to other, actually even the indigenous tribes as well. For instance, La Mola, which is this, it's an a textile. It shows images. They traditionally did it on their skin. It usually showed animals or designs or images that they wanted to portray. And they usually did it in their bodies with a specific kind of ink they concocted in the jungle. But it later evolved, because of French immigrants actually, into la mola, which is using the technique of applique, which is they sort of like do a double, sorry, I'm thinking the word in Spanish, it's using like two fabrics and just making the design. It's very colorful. And for instance, that is another example of how it took something from another culture that came in and evolved into something so exemplary of Panama. And there are many others as well, sort of from the Antilles, the sort of like the African Antilles involvement in our Caribbean coast. And you can see that the traditional dress there takes a whole, a very different style as well. It's, for instance, it's more like the simple pollera, but it has a lot of cuts, and they adapted it to sort of merge with their culture, which they brought from the Antilles and before that Africa. And so it's a bit of a mix. It's a melting pot in Panama, actually. Everyone has roots from everywhere, so it's just a bit of a melting pot in that way, culturally and in terms of people as well. Is that good?
Hi, I actually visited Panama about 10 years ago, and I had an extraordinary experience with the Kuna Indians.
Ah, yes.
We spent some time on a very tiny remote island, and it was really the highlight of the trip. And I just wondered what your government is doing to protect, if you can expand more on what your government is doing to protect the indigenous tribes.
Yes, well, the Kuna, for instance, is actually the best example of protection an indigenous tribe can have, actually in the whole region, because they are very politically autonomous. They select their own leaders, and they are they follow their own customs. They are not imposed of anything by the government, although the government does can provide and help in other ways, but they are very much sort of the masters of their own affairs. In terms of security, obviously, the government does get involved, security in the border with Colombia and so forth. With other tribes, it can vary slightly. Some have their own territories, and they have a political authority as well. But it's also complemented a bit with the regional government. For instance, if there are territories in the region, sort of like in Veraguas, they deal a lot with the central government there, with the governor in that area. And so far, they are still even developing even more ties as well, just like increasing funding from the state. Because while Zacunas actually can manage to be a bit more economically independent because they have such beautiful islands and the tourism is booming in that area, they actually have a bit more of economical freedom, whilst the others depend a bit more on the government for funding. So the government actually quite recently, a couple of weeks ago, we increased the funding for that area, for the Embera tribe. And it just allows them to manage themselves much better. We're trying to just to keep give them autonomy, but if they depend on the government, then to make sure that their culture is not lost and that their people are actually, you know, have the opportunities to work and to choose their way in life. We don't want it to be different from the opportunities other Panamanians can have as well. So that would be the focus of the situation.